Fracking community, I'm going to tell you my story, but it's not really my story. It's all our story, and there are many, many people that have been fracked and are living my story a little bit differently. Actions and omissions speak louder than words. This is my community. It's my properties over here. This is the church parking lot. We have wetlands. This was just a few months ago, and our water is already too dangerous to even use to flush toilets. In my experience, we have best in the world laws and regulations in Alberta. Not just regulations, but laws. Water laws to protect water and environment. I do not believe that they protect us from this new brute force fracking. Rosebud is just northeast of Calgary in Alberta. A few acronyms you need to know: CBM, coal bed methane. I read that they're planning to possibly do coal bed methane in Ireland as well as here. Some companies, and some people call it natural gas from coal or coal seam gas. Our National Energy Board has a report where they say the shallow shales will be fracked, and not only that, the biogenic shales made by bacteria. Everywhere that water goes bad, when there's bacteriological or biogenic methane in the water, bacteria are blamed. And the companies say, oh no, we're only fracking far below the impermeable layer to prevent gas migration. It's not us. They are fracking the biogenic methane. Does anyone here not know what fracking is? So I should just have stayed home. No, that's fantastic. Just even a few months ago, a year ago, quite a lot of people would reluctantly put their hand up. And this entire tour, there was only one person. That's incredible, that shows a big shift. This is a propaganda document from our regulator. They're showing a coal bed methane well here that would be shallow. This dotted line is the fresh water, where the fresh water is. It's the base of groundwater protection. There are shales up here, and there are coals up here. This would be a deep horizontal shale. They can do 2 kilometer lengths up to 3 kilometers. Here's a waste disposal well. This is the casing, the steel and cement casing. They promise us will protect our water. What they don't tell us is that they blast holes in the casing so that the frack fluids can be injected. Not just here, but here. And in my community, the company fractured right into where the fresh water is, where our aquifers are. And in Alberta, they are fracking thousands of wells above the basic groundwater protection. A few key players: EnCana, after we filed the first legal papers, they split off their big oil riches into another company called Cenovus. Our energy regulator used to be the utilities board. After they were caught spying on Albertans and breaking the law, the government changed their name. I think they do this so that the good old Albertans keep voting for the corrupt government that we have. They forget. Well, our energy regulator is soon to be swallowed by a new energy regulator. They're calling it the super regulator. A lawyer in Alberta called it the Frankenchild. Yeah. And new, they will have immunity from omissions. Immunity for failing to protect us. Immunity for failing to protect water. I'm an oil and gas industry consultant. I've worked in the industry for 30 years. I am suing EnCana, one of the nastiest companies out there. They're not the biggest, but they're nasty. The Alberta government and our energy utilities board. One of the big parts of my lawsuit is that they didn't have the word omissions in their immunity clause. Our water protector, the Alberta Environment Group, they are too going to be swallowed up by the new super regulator, and they will be completely immune from lawsuits. They didn't used to be. They protect our fresh water. The Research Council was also involved. They too changed names, and when they were the Research Council, they stated boldly and proudly on their website they were meeting the priorities of industry. There's an EnCana logo there. I'll tell you a little bit of connection later on. I'm going to start with some history. You have lots and lots of history here. It's incredible to be presenting in a building like this with the art and the history and the memories of where we came from. We don't have a lot of that in Alberta. We have First Nations history, but, well, some water history. They looked at 1,000 water wells in Springs. Most of them had no methane. And the highest concentrations of methane increased where energy wellbore density increased. The samples that did have methane, most had less than 0.3 milligrams per liter. In 1985, there was a very serious explosion. A department store blew up, $23 million in damage, or sorry, 23 people hurt, millions of dollars in damages. They thought this could be tied to an oil field. The gas chief said, the fire chief said this gas burning through the parking lot could burn off for months. They threw together a task force very quickly, and they wrote a report. The gas was biogenic. Already in 1985, they had decided, let's blame bacteria. Pressurized by rising water table, there was a massive class action lawsuit, unfortunately settled out of court. Historic water wells in my community, gas present, yes or no? On my water well, no. A county well, a neighbor's well, no. This is the actual data on my well from 1986. I blew the important part up for you. My legal team looked at 2,300 such historic records in my community within about 50 square kilometers around my water well. Only four had a gas that could have been methane present. Only 0.17%. It's not very many. This is before the experimental shallow fracking began. The EPA had a documented case of fracking contaminating groundwater in America. But they lied to us, industry, regulators, even the EPA. They said for the longest time, there's never been a documented case. What's interesting about this case, the company that was involved in this wants to frack Calgary, where a lot of the big oil and gas managers live, and they don't like it. 200 strong had placards and were protesting in Calgary. Our Minister of Energy is now creating an urban energy policy. People in the rural areas don't get one. There were reportedly hundreds of other cases of contamination from fracking sealed by gag orders, non-disclosure order agreements, confidentiality agreements. I will not sign one of these. I'm doing the lawsuit all the way to the end. I will not settle out of court because this is too important. Husky did some research on their leaking energy wells. They concluded it's a big problem, expensive to fix, and they can't ever really fix it. 46% of the energy wells they tested were leaking. The photograph is of energy wells in my community. These are EnCana wells. On here, they have to state the address. It's like a postal address. We call it a legal land description. And in that report, they said that they were beginning to think the biogenic methane was leaking up the oil and gas energy wells. Everywhere that I've known where water wells have become contaminated with methane, bacteria is the culprit. Bacteria is blamed. But they already knew such a long time ago that the energy wells are likely causing the swamp gas, the naturally occurring methane, the bacteriological methane, to leak up their wells into groundwater. A very important study by the American Geological Survey, there were many water wells that went bad in America from coal bed methane. At the time, a number of landowners, they complained quite a lot. They did some studies, and Chapin did not find nature to blame. The gas wells were responsible, more than natural fractures. Man-made migration pathways caused most of the near surface gas. This is again a photograph in my community. These are all legals. There's 34 energy wells there. The unconventional oil and gas, that's coal bed methane, your sands, your shales, shale oil, shale gas, they come with an unprecedented impact. They have to drill more and more and more and more wells. And they have to blast more and more holes in the casing, and they come back and frack again and again. Our big oil and gas lobby group, the Canadian Association of Petroleum Producers, they too studied the problem of methane leaking from energy wells. They even titled their paper, Migration of Methane into Groundwater, caused by their leaking wells, not by nature. They got the Saskatchewan Research Council to do the research and our water regulator in Alberta. They did the same thing my legal team did, but they looked at 2,400 historic records just on the Alberta side. Before oil and gas development, before conventional oil and gas development, only 0.07% had a gas present that could have been methane after oil and gas, but before the new brute force fracking. The same percentage that my legal team found had gas present. That's the data there. This is before oil and gas, this is after. They said that the dissolved methane in groundwater is an important indicator. Useful data on dissolved methane in groundwater is used in the region. I consider this important baseline. Most of the water wells, yes, had methane in them, but at very low levels. Experts have told me natural methane in water wells does not dramatically increase, and it's usually at very low levels. They reported that just over, the two highest were just over one risk of explosion. Does happen if water has 1 milligram per liter methane and that water passes a confined space. The methane can move into and through aquifers. This is how they thought it happened in those days. The dotted lines are the pathways through the casing and along the side of the casing. I bought my place in 1998. I love beauty. You have a lot of beauty here. It's so beautiful here. It's incredible. This is the Rosebud River on my land. The yellow is canola. That land belongs to my neighbor. That's my garden. 15 years later, researchers began to look at what happened to the explosion in Los Angeles. They called the report imaginative. Troublesome legal issues eliminated. How convenient. Unscientific, happy, blameless ending. The implication being that the methane hazard could exist anywhere with no one being held accountable. I've read an awful lot of papers, and I think this is one of the most important quotes I've ever read in this. Hutchinson, Kansas, first responders had a very difficult time trying to put these explosions out. They traveled underground the next day, 3 miles, killing 2 people. That's the water there. Trican and Husky got together. Trican is a big frack company in Alberta, and they looked at their leaking energy wells, 12 to 80% leaking. Our ministers of environment, these are our politicians in Canada, they held a very important workshop before the fracking began, or sort of before. I didn't find out any of this information until years later. They wrote a report, unconventional gas drilling poses a real threat to quality and quantity. It's not safe, like they're telling us publicly. And that we need proper baseline hydrogeological testing and monitoring, we still don't have that in Canada. And Canada didn't care. In 2001, they did not respect the pregnant women or children in my community. They didn't respect any of us. They began experimenting. They treated us like guinea pigs. They did this in secret. These wells were all completed above the basic groundwater protection. That's above the dotted line in that diagram I showed you. In 2001, they perforated at 100.5 meters below the surface. I consider that evil. In 2004, they perforated and fracked directly into the aquifers that supply my community. Oh, let's go back to the stop sign. More land descriptions. These are mandatory to be posted, but that's a stop sign. They're not allowed to do that. They promise us that they're going to follow the laws and regulations. That's how they treat the law. I didn't know any of that. I didn't know what they were doing, and I work in this industry. I was even working for EnCana at the time. Lots of noise. An incredible amount of noise. Construction noise, backup beepers, flaring noise, drilling noise, perforation rigs, racing trucks going way too fast, slamming on their engine retarder brakes. It's an industrialization. It's an invasion. My neighbor came to me and said, Jess, my water well went bad. You better get your well tested. EnCana wants to do more wells. They did some wells around me. Lucky for me, EnCana came. They did not report visible gas in my water. This is the test, 2003. On EnCana's website, they stated last year, they've changed their words a little bit because they've been called on it, that I'm uncooperative and I won't let them test my water well. Well, I have an EnCana test on my well. I asked for a test. Water appearance clear. We have a report from the Research Council. Natural methane release from coal formations in Alberta is rare. The reason it's rare is because the formations are tight. The unconventional oil and gas does not naturally want to let go. That is why they have to force it to let go with fracking. When I went public with that report, they pulled it off the internet. Researchers to the Hutchinson, Kansas explosions, they can fingerprint where gases come from. When the police fingerprint the man who looked like he was running out of the bank with all the money, and they go into the vault and they fingerprint the vault and they can get a match to the other 9 robbers who were all in the pub, maybe were hanging around the bank at the same time, they can figure out who did it. Well, they can do that with gas migrating into water also. They proved that it was industries leaking gas and it had migrated almost 7 miles, killing 2 people. Back to Los Angeles, nearly 20 years later, more research? No, it was not bacteria. It was not pressurized water causing the gas to be pressured into this store and causing all those injuries. Industries leaking gas. This is the data of EnCana perforating into our aquifers. This is energy wellbore data. This is with the energy regulator. When they come and perforate for the unconventionals, they perforate holes in many zones. This is 24 different zones of depths. This is the water well database in Alberta. This is data that the water regulator has on file. It's got EnCana on the title. Here it says intention to frack for coal bed methane. I blew up the depths. The most shallow, 121.5 meters below the surface, they were on a hilltop. Our water wells are in the valley. They did this in secret. They didn't give us a chance to test our water wells, to have the pregnant women bathe somewhere else or take their babies. You are way ahead of us, because at least you know. A manager with our regulator admitted in a presentation that was being done to industry and water testing labs and other things like that, shallow operations can be high risk. They did not tell Albertans. Water wells started to go bad. Here's the first ones that went bad. This is the EnCana well that fracked 2 aquifers, my well's over here. They still will not tell us what chemicals they injected. They won't tell you before, and they sure won't tell you after you're fracked. So EnCana investigates itself. What have we done in the world that we allow the bank robber who ran out with all your money? Do you have banks in this town? Or do you have to go to London?
Not as far.
Not as far. All right. We don't have banks in my little town. But when does the bank robber get to do his own fingerprinting? He's holding the money and he's going to say, well, that's my fingerprint, but that's not my fingerprint. EnCana investigates itself. Oh no, we didn't do it. And they blame with the regulator. They blamed our local water well driller. He was so furious, he quit because he was doing a lot of work for EnCana. I was also working for EnCana. They were probably one of my best clients. I was doing consultation work for them up north. The type of work I did was cumulative effects assessments, caribou protection plans, monitoring using non-invasive methods on Fisher, Martin, Wolverine. It was an incredible career. I worked my whole life for this career. I was consulting for them far up north. And my neighbors came to me and said, geez, Jess, can you help us out? We've got this document. It doesn't really seem to be legitimate, and the EnCana landman is pressuring us to sign it. And when we ask questions, is this about coal bed methane? Is this that fracking? They won't answer our questions. It was a blanket approval type document, signing away basically a lot of their rights. I looked at it, I said, this is not compliant, there's an EnCana manager on the form, I'll call him up. I did. We talked. I said, consult, have a meeting like this. Tell the community what you want to do. Albertans are very accommodating to oil and gas. And he said, no. If we can get them all to sign the document, we don't have to consult. I was pretty shocked. So I talked quite a long time trying to keep my temper in check. I said, you have to consult. So he promised to hold an open house, and a few days later, the same neighbors came back with the same document saying the landman was using the same tricks and the same lies and trying to get them to sign the same non-compliant document. I went for a walk with my two dogs, knowing I was walking down the road to hell, likely never to get off it. I resigned in writing. How could I work for a company lying to my community and lying to me? So EnCana finally has their open house. I still, of course, was in contact with some really good workers at EnCana. There's good people at these companies. They were aghast at what was going on. I finished my contract for EnCana. I didn't leave them. It wasn't a contract. I was working on a project. I didn't leave them in the lurch, but since my resignation, I didn't charge them until the project was completed. They have an open house, and they look us in the eye. And they said, we will never frack your water supply. This is October. The data I showed you was March of this year. Then they even promised, we're going to be way below this impermeable layer to prevent gas migrating into your water. And then they did another evil thing. They gave a little bit of money to one part of the community. We have a beautiful little dinner theater in Rosebud. We have golf courses and bed and breakfasts and other businesses, but just the dinner theater got the promise. They cannot, in my opinion, frack healthy communities. So they give a little bit of money to buy the silence and the obedience and to make the community sick. A few months later, my water well is a private water well, the hamlet of about 100 people. They have a municipal water supply. The concrete reservoir blew up in an explosion, seriously injuring a worker. They blamed a propane torch. I was very busy with other clients at the time. I didn't really even pay any attention because they told us there was going to be no coal bed, nothing, no fracking, don't worry. We'll never frack your water supply. I didn't know the information that I've just shared with you. But a few years later, preparing a talk to do in New York, I went through newspaper articles, archives, and found this quote. Accumulation of gases. There's the old reservoir, and EnCana promised 150,000. The new one is underground, and that cost the people almost $700,000. They're still paying for this, and they'll be paying a long time. The people paid. And EnCana hadn't given the promised money yet. My water dramatically changed. My water well became a better gas well. I had sometimes so much gas coming out of my water taps, I couldn't close them. I didn't know what it was. Incredibly painful caustic burns. I got cracks on the top of my hands from doing dishes. There was so much gas in my water that it was spurting out and would wet the toilet seat, would wet the tub when running a bath. Similar to the water in Hutchinson, Kansas, but of course not to any, nowhere near as serious of a degree. I didn't know what it was. We were taught growing up, we have infinite fresh water in Canada. Never did it occur to me it was the water, until one day I poured water for my dogs, and they backed away from it in revulsion. This is my water after fracking. The test by EnCana on my well in 2003 said appearance clear. I'm lucky to have colleagues that worked on that gas migration research. They came and looked. They were shocked. One of them loaned me his professional methane detector. He said, you're living in danger. The methane detector isn't even going to protect you. You shouldn't even be in this house. So I got my methane tested. The noise is getting worse. And I started noticing that the regulator, every time I presented evidence of non-compliance, they softened the rules to match the non-compliance. And they tried to increase the industrial noise allowed to match EnCana's non-compliant noise. It was like a jet engine taking off in the beginning. EnCana didn't have any attenuation. It was extremely terrible. Disrupt sleep, very annoying. So I warned Albertans that they were trying to increase the allowable noise. They never did get away with that because of me warning people. And I went off to the Yukon to talk to people like I am to you tonight, and I came home thinking I'd get regulation, but no, I was banished. I'm a really boring Canadian. I adhere to the law. I don't party. I'm really boring. I couldn't believe this. I couldn't believe it. A neighbor was with me because I just came home from the Yukon when I read my mail, and my neighbor was so afraid she had to sit down. She said, "I'm going to faint. What happens if they throw you in jail?" So I said, "Well, you'll have to bring me my laptop and take care of my dogs." The interesting thing about this, it's a very large part of the lawsuit. They gave me a great gift because they put it in writing. This is how arrogant. It's the same manager, Jim Reed, that presented a year prior to saying shallow operations can be high risk. He copied our Royal Canadian Mounted Police. He copied the EUB Field Surveillance Branch Security. This was to intimidate me. I believe that they knew EnCana had fracked our aquifers. I was presenting evidence of non-compliance about the noise and other problems. I think they thought they could scare me, and they needed to scare me because they did not want me to find out EnCana had fracked our drinking water supply. I read the letter. It's the date that the letter was in the mailbox. Doesn't matter where I was, in the Yukon or anywhere at the time. And I wrote questions asking, under what legislation can you judge us guilty without a trial? And this is how serious they took my banishment. They refused my mail. Refused by addressee. And this was in my mailbox the same day. This was on the front page of the Edmonton Journal. That's my water. In the meantime, I had received back the water well tests, and a journalist from the Edmonton Journal had heard about me in the Yukon and wanted an interview, so we opened the data when she was there. And then our regulator came out with a little bit, at the time I believed they were trying to tighten regulations. Now when I look back at it, it's a scam. Albertans were getting upset. There was a big article in the media. So they said they were going to do these regulations. They were going to put restrictions on shallow fracking just for coal bed methane. I believe they did this to make Albertans go back to sleep, and it worked. Two very important things though. Industry admitted that they had shallow fracks shooting out other wellbores. They also admitted that they did not know what their shallow fracks did. When I went public with this, they pulled the directive off their website. This is a regulator. And they removed these damning statements. I've been saving everything and putting them on my website. So the regulator has their altered directive. My website has the original directive. Our government knew they had failed us. They promised safe alternate water now and into the future, not just for me, for all affected families, regardless of whether bacteria caused it or not. And then they came finally to test my water. They knew already from 2004, they ought to have been monitoring our water throughout the community. The tester was shocked by how much gas was in my water. He looked at my empty fields. I'm a consultant, I can't stay home and take care of livestock. He says, "You don't have cattle, so you caused the contamination. You don't use enough water." 3 days later, we have a meeting with the Minister of Environment and his hydrogeological staff. We are to blame because we use too much water. Me with my two little dogs. This is best in the world science. Alberta, we have the best. We have the most experience with oil and gas. Now, can you see that at the back with the lights up? Yeah, this is about 13 square miles. It's a radius of about 6 miles around my property. This is where the water tower blew up. The solid red dots are the gas wells EnCana fractured less than 200 meters below the surface. The circles, all the red, All of those were fracked where the fresh water is, above the base of groundwater protection. The black are the deeper conventional wells and the unconventional wells. It is an unprecedented invasion. So those red wells were fracked up here. This was a document from 2011. Our regulator is still misleading the Alberta public. They don't tell you the truth before you get fracked, and they don't tell you the truth after you get fracked. And then those wells just go to April 2006. For example, here, EnCana's just put a new well over here. They've drilled under my land. They've put two new ones here. I've deviated this way. It never stops. And the government mandated baseline testing. The politicians knew years earlier that they were going to do this and that these unconventionals were high risk and that we needed to monitor the water. They also they fingerprinted the gases in the water wells in Rosebud, and they found by two different labs that they matched the gas from EnCana's wells, but they didn't tell anybody. I found this out by freedom of information 2 years later. That's one copy of the data. Some of the chemicals in the community water supply, evidence of petroleum distillates, benzene, ethylbenzene, toluene damages the brain, phthalates. They also found hexavalent and chromium in a monitoring well. That's what made Aaron Brockovich famous. My water, the chromium went up by a factor of 45 after EnCana fracks the aquifer that supplies my well. Phthalates, tert-butyl alcohol, the same toxics that were found in some of the contamination cases in America in frack fields, and also evidence of petroleum distillates. This is in the rain in my community. This is the Bruce Jack water well. This is his water. Reminds me of Hutchinson, Kansas. The government admitted that it looked like it was industry-sourced gas in his water, but they wouldn't do anything for him. It took him a long time to fight, and he finally got two industry gas testers to come to fingerprint the gas in his water. They were getting out of his truck. He went to turn his water well on. They were in hospital, seriously injured. Bruce had to sell his herd. Gesundheit. This is what we have in our Rosebud water. 30 to 66 milligrams per liter of methane. We also have ethane. Some of the water wells have propane and butane. My water well, the historic record, gas present, no. The big oil and gas lobby groups, baseline data, not for our community specifically, but regional data, most less than 0.05. The Saskatchewan study, most less than 0.3. Risk of explosion at 1. This is a dangerous problem, as the task force knew in 1985 when the store blew up in Los Angeles. There was a briefing note by the Research Council that I found years later via Freedom of Information. They weren't even involved yet, but they stated in a briefing note to ministers of the environment in Alberta and Ontario that they were going to blame bacteria and we wouldn't like it. And they don't admit that the companies are fracking the biogenic methane. This is during the government investigation of the community-wide contamination in my community. This is a nitrogen frack. My water well's about a mile this way. This is where they fracked the aquifers. This is during the investigation. And EnCana twice said publicly that they did not have to cooperate with this investigation. And this was fracked above the basic groundwater protection, too. We go back to my banishment. This is, I'm very honored that there are legal people here tonight. I'm really thrilled about that. This is the energy regulator lawyer. This is me. I didn't do this diagram. I got it off the internet. When they tried to intimidate me, I think they thought I was a middle-aged woman alone. I work in the industry. I'm sure they thought I was going to go quiet. But I started speaking. I thought, people need to know about this. So I think they realized, uh-oh, we've just violated her charter rights and she's talking about it, we better scare her some more, try to shut her up. So they did McCarthy like red baiting. It was an interrogation. It was hideous. It was terrifying. I still have nightmares. And I will never be proud to be Canadian again. They tell us we have to accept the fracking for security of our country to be good nationals. But I wasn't trusting anything anymore, so I asked permission to tape record my interrogation, and this lawyer admitted on tape that I had never done anything that was a threat, that they never considered me a threat. And he admitted the regulator was in the wrong. When I went public, though, they started to blame bacteria. They also said all water wells in coal are naturally contaminated with methane. But their very own study, 90% of the water wells in coal had no methane or ethane. All of the industry CBM wells they tested had biogenic methane. This is a big problem, expensive to fix, difficult to completely stop, all over the world. This was their first key conclusion. They've gathered experts from all over the world to solve this problem. And now they want to frack everywhere, and they haven't solved this big problem yet. Big oil and gas lobby group, another one. They're admitting they're going to frack in their document. They don't tell the public, shallow shales in Saskatchewan, 300 to 700 meters. Somebody told me tonight that sun and that's getting pretty close to some of the shales they want to frack here, Ireland. Biogenic gas. The company that wanted to frack Ireland has already said, oh, well, that's already happened in Ireland. You can set the water on fire. Both legislatures, that question was asked, and the water regulator said, no, there's no cases of that. Our big oil and gas lobby group testified to a parliamentary committee. I also testified there, and he said, if we find methane in water, we presume it's naturally occurring. All methane is naturally occurring. Fracking is not natural. So our government decides to do some monitoring wells in the hamlet. A water well we use, the monitoring wells we monitor. This is the well here. This is the lid. This is in the community. It's on a trail where kids would race with dirt bikes. I went to have a look when they were finished, and the lid was going like this. So I called one of my colleagues who'd studied gas migration. He said, back out of there very, very slowly. This is very dangerous. They didn't even put flagging tape. A PhD geochemist from the Research Council was on this site, a regulator with Alberta Environment, 20 years experience, and the driller. They knew they had a problem. They admitted they had a problem, and they went home. They didn't even tell the volunteer fire department. They didn't provide methane detectors. So we called 911, and we got yelled at because we were putting in EnCana's promise of $150,000 in jeopardy. That's how well those bribes work. They work really well. It's how close to a home they came and cased later on. It's illegal to leave gases venting like that for obvious reasons. This is how close to toddlers. There's the well there. This is the monitoring well that found the hexavalent chromium. The government finally commits to a proper investigation, but they switched labs. They detected ethane in our water. They already knew the ethane indicated a match to EnCana, and they didn't fingerprint it. And then there was a big presentation. This presentation is by our energy regulator with a consultant. This became in 2009 a peer-reviewed paper. Very serious problem. Factors affecting leakage. They now know that where the swamp gas is, where the shallow bacteriological naturally occurring methane is, higher potential for leakage. Here's the production zones. They now know many more ways that the gas goes up the casing. This perfect casing, they tell us, will protect our water. My dog Bandit was killed October 2007. And shortly after that, I found this document to my horror. Enemies of the State, by a law professor at the University of Calgary. She misused hearing transcripts about me. It's very difficult to live with stuff like this. I'm just doing my due diligence. I have a business. I have an incorporated business. It's my responsibility to tell people. So the Research Council is retained by Alberta Environment to look at their investigation of EnCana fracking our aquifers, but their annual report says that they were getting money from EnCana and our water regulator. Conflict of interest. This is the actual page out of their annual report. This is the fellow who left the gas monitoring well dangerously venting. He's the one who wrote his reports. Here's where that damning statement is. When I went public with that, they removed this off the internet, pulled the damning statement out, added another here, and put it back on the internet. And the council, true enough, they blamed bacteria and nature, but they said, we don't know where the methane came from. They ignored the historic data. They ignored the data from 2003. They ignored lots of things. And instead of looking at the fingerprints showing the bank robber was in the bank vault, they went to a bank 100 miles away to wells that were fracked deeper, and they said no match. So we didn't like that. We did a media alert rejecting what the government did. They promised us water now and into the future. That was in the legislature. And on the very morning we did this, EnCana donated $7.5 million to the University of Alberta. That is the lab that found the match to EnCana's gas. They take away our water. I go 45 minutes to get water in the winter time when it's 30 below. It's too hard for me to do. I very, very much have to ration water. Tonight, I had the most amazing bath. I did. I have, you know, the Irish, north and south, they're really mean. There's no time for bathing over there. I wanted a bath in Ireland, but there wasn't time. And tonight was the first time I had time on this tour. When I landed at the airport on March 1st, the customs man, he said to me, oh, are you here on a holiday? When are you going home? 12th. No, I'm not on holiday. Oh, you're here on business. Well, no. It's very important, I believe, especially with this fight, to be honest. So I said, well, actually, I'm speaking on fracking. Oh, he said, that's really controversial. This is in Dublin. That's amazing, though. That's a really good sign. My heart was pounding, thinking, wow, this is in the city. Cities don't usually care what happens to rural people. So I said, he said, so are you for or against? I said, well, I'm not really either. I live it. And he said, what do you mean you live it? I said, well, I got fracked. You got fracked? I said, yes, they fracked our water supply. Huh? And then I said to him, the first thing I'm going to do when I get over out into Ireland is I'm going to have a bath in your unfracked, safe Irish water. But I had to wait till here. I have to pay for the water. I wanted to buy a car. My career is toast. I can't really afford a truck, especially not with legal fees, but I have to haul water. This is Bandit's brother. Doesn't matter how hot it is, and I want him to stay home. His life is high stress because I've been horrifically abused because of rocking the big oil boat in my country. It's taken a terrible toll on him. But he always comes along, and it always breaks my heart. Now we're back home. I had to take a window apart to unload the water. I gave up my laundry room. And national TV aired a very little segment on my water, a bunch of other ranchers as well with contamination, I'm not the only one, and how badly they treated me. And a few days later, they started lying to me, harassing me. I got my lawyers involved. I was horrified, but I started laughing. The first one who phoned me, he said, well, Miss Ernst, blah, 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 and I started laughing. This is very serious. He said, how come you're laughing? I said, well, because Saturday night, 7 o'clock, the national news has me on, and here you are, Monday morning, lying to me, harassing me. Like, it's just so expected. Well, he was very angry. Here they are. This is my home. It's very beautiful. Here they come. That's my yard. They sent the RCMP, the Royal Canadian Mounted Police. Again, we had just served the legal papers. So he hears me, this guy, the big guy, he hears me taking photographs, because I don't trust anybody anymore. I certainly don't trust the police anymore. When I'm in trouble, I know I have nobody to call. And he says, "You can't take our pictures. We're undercover." Yeah, but you know, it is really funny now. But you have to make a stand. And I said, "You're trespassing. My lawyers and I told you we would come to you." My lawyers told the police, "She has been through enough. Her home is her sanctuary. Don't go there." I made these guys phone my lawyers. They asked if they had a warrant. They didn't. My lawyers told them to leave. They were leaving. We have the same anti-terrorist act that George Bush put into place. I've done a lot of research by this time. I was worried for my files. I went against my own lawyer's instructions. Am I in trouble now? I decided to interrogate. I'd been through an interrogation with the big bully. I figured, these guys, I can deal with this. And I thought, I better cooperate, give them what they want. I don't want to put my research at risk. So I gave the lead interrogator, it was February, wintertime, cold, and I gave the lead interrogator my metal chair. I took the wooden chair. I was telling a journalist after, and he said, "Whoa, what a shrewd way to cut short an interrogation." I offered honey, tea, Kleenex when his nose began running, and I answered their questions. And I know it was purely intimidation for a lot of reasons, but I can't go into it all. It's a whole story of its own. If bacteria did this to my water, would they spend taxpayer money to do this? Scare a middle-aged woman? Our National Energy Board, only 20% of the shales can be recovered. We now have a problem. We're rendering everything impermeable. What's going to happen to the 80%? And David Hughes just wrote a fantastic report, just came out, Drill Baby Drill. He's looked at the shales in America, they're only getting 10%. Is it worth it? Can we not create jobs that are better, more sustainable? They also said that the shales will be limited by fresh water. Flowback is not recycled, because of scaling and corrosion. And now, do you remember in 2006 when industry admitted they didn't know what their shallow fracks did? In British Columbia, in the Horn, they're doing massive fracks up there. These are on the very deep horizontals now. People say, "Oh, well, you don't want to listen to Jessica because that's a shallow frack problem." And it's obvious. One of the politicians said in Stormont, he said, "It's obvious you're going to win your lawsuit. What they did is terrible. But we got deep stuff here." Not in Ireland, it's actually shallow. But on the very deep horizontals, they were having frack outs, where the frack fluids were shooting out other energy well bores. At this time, in 2010, they had 18 of them already. That's not just one or two. So the regulator put out an advisory, and industry admitted they didn't know what their deep fracks do. This is an experiment. And EnCana gives the money. 2010, they promised it in 2004. They doubled it up. Our regulator has a report. They're admitting the shallow shales and deep shales will be fracked. They don't tell the public this. They admit it's a risk. They tell the public it's safe. Quadrilla, you never have control. Fractures will always go into the path of least resistance. That's what's been happening in British Columbia and Alberta. This is a gas frack with all the water concerns. The company said, "Don't worry about the water. What we'll do is we'll frack with propane." This is not what a frack looks like. This is an explosion. It went wrong. Lots of injuries. The propane fracks still need chemicals to gel. They're so dangerous, they're becoming almost totally robotic. My lawsuit went public in April of 2011. The Jackson study came out. Jackson's been the one who's been talking to the press. Scientifically, I ought to call it the Osborne study. Now they've quantified the problem. They knew about it in the 80s, they knew about it in the 90s. 17 times more methane near drilled and fracked wells. The Canadian government appointed Judge Veltois to the Court of Queen's Bench. She later became my case management judge. Now back to gas frack. This is not the explosion. This is a different incident, but it's the same company. They accidentally perforated into fresh water on a very deep horizontal well. And EnCana intentionally perforated into our fresh water. The regulators did nothing but abuse me. In this case, they knew. The regulator, the energy regulator, and Alberta Environment knew for over a year. And they still lied to us. And they removed the limits on all the unconventional oil and gas. They promised publicly best in the world regulations. Behind closed doors, they take them away and more. They've put in a whole bunch of new laws that have decimated the rights of Albertans. And it's never enough. This is EnCana drilling under my land on an angle, right in line with my water well in 2011. My water's been too dangerous to even use to flush toilets. These two trucks here are collecting the waste. These are wells here and compressors, straw bale wall to pretend they're doing something about the noise. I was very worried about the waste because we already have lots of problems with the coal bed methane and the other wells. The fish scale shales, the deep, is reportedly radioactive in my community. I asked the company, what are you going to do with the waste? I asked the regulator in letters. The regulator wrote back and said, don't worry, they won't dump it adjacent to your land. So they went a mile over. Somebody told me they're very interested in agriculture and food. I am too, because I love to eat when there's time. This is the waste that's being collected. And I was with a photographer and we actually saw these trucks leave and go down the road, drive over to here. It was very windy. It blows a lot in Alberta. We could see the waste going airborne. It was a Sunday, and the people were coming out of the church in the valley below. They would be breathing this. And EnCana has research on, this is recycled frac fluid, and this is drilling waste. Arsenic, barium, chromium, mercury. We're breathing that. We're eating it. Someone in Michigan said, what are they going to do with all the waste? And I said, we're going to eat and drink it if we don't stop it. And EnCana has a document that says they work it in right away to prevent harmful effects. Here's a Chinook arch, it was very windy. I went back a month later, the ground was frozen. They didn't work it in. They don't care. They say they care. They say they need you for their social license to operate, and me. Dr. Carlos Muhlenbach, who did the fingerprinting indicating the match to EnCana, he says the fracking contamination will get worse. We have a blowout in Alberta. I found out later that we've had many, but none of them went public. The landowner came home. The frack fluids and oil were shooting out of this well. He called the regulator's emergency response line and received no answer. He called a service rights group. Hi, Vanessa, I got a problem. Can you come help? Does Vanessa get paid? Is she an expert? Do you have emergency gear? Do you have safety gear for working in toxic chemicals? They are working, cleaning this up. They don't know what the chemicals are. We still don't know what those chemicals were. No safety gear. The product, the frack fluids and oil were dripping off the trees, and the Red Deer River is on the other side. The Red Deer River is where I now get my drinking water from. Can you see that at the back? Not very well. There's a stop sign. This is nighttime. A man came driving down the county road. We paid for these roads, and there was a truck with the valve open at the back, reeked of diesel. So he said to the fellow, "What are you doing?" "Oh, don't worry, it's just water." The citizen was very smart. He called the police. Albertans are starting to figure out it's a waste of time to call the regulator. A mother with two young children waited for her husband to come home. It was winter time. At midnight, a citizen went out to take photographs. It still reeked of diesel. 2 days later, if this was water, you wouldn't see it. The waste that comes with this new unconventional oil and gas is phenomenal. I looked around at your fields here. I was given a quick tour from the road of the site. All these hills and vales and the wetlands and the water and the rain. Where are they going to put this waste? They promised tanks, they promised lined pits, they promised waste injection, but all of that costs money. This is free. Well, sort of free. It's pretty cheap. Ontario, they want to frack the biogenic methane. The National Energy Board has that in their report. Tax Assessment Review Board reduced methane contaminated property to zero. We, the little people, keep the counties going. We pay for the roads. We may not make the counties rich. We don't give big promises like the fracking companies, but we sustain our communities. What if the counties can't get taxes off us anymore? In Drumheller Court last April, we had our first hearing. Drumheller is a little rural town of about 5,000, very close to my community. The harm took place in my community. Legally, cases are to be heard where the harm took place. So there we were in Drumheller. The regulator demands that my original statement of claim is not only removed from the public record, but struck from the court. The judge didn't give this. All three defendants demanded that I pay their legal fees. The judge said, "We'll wait on that." So for 2 years, I don't know what I was breathing in, maybe longer. I don't know what I was breathing coming out of my taps. I don't know what I was bathing in. The government hauled water for a few years. I'm hauling water now into the fifth year. And this happened. The Plains Midstream sour crude oil spill into the Red Deer River, where I get my water from. They've already detected BTEX in the drinking water supply. Where do I go to get water? Nationwide insurance. Risks are too great to ignore. The investors and the insurance companies will probably put a stop to this before any of the regulators or companies. They're getting very nervous. There's a video on my website linked on the speaking events in 2010 at the Monk School of Global Affairs for Water, and an insurance company spoke there saying, if we find out that these companies lied to us and told us fracking was not a risk, they could be in big trouble. EU report that came out last year, 25 to 100% of the water is lost forever. You may think you have too much water here today. We don't get a lot of rain in Alberta. I love this. Lost forever. Your roads, water's heavy. Up at Lancashire, we went to tour Quadrilla's site, and I was stunned by the damage to the roads already. And then I looked, as we toured around, and I looked and I went, oh, they've put the well right where the waste management company is. That's so shrewd, because they can blame the trucks and you, the people up there, for the damage to the roads. Who's going to pay to fix your roads? Earthquakes. Northwest of Calgary, where a lot of the very wealthy people live, $8 million homes, $5 million homes. The real estate market is hot right now, but nobody's buying. More and more properties go up for sale all the time, the richest ones. They're being fracked. Damages to windows and foundations in America, skyrocketing costs for insurance, class action lawsuit. The two earthquakes that happened here, well, in America they've had them too, and they kept saying, oh, but not directly related to fracking. The regulator in British Columbia with the federal government and industry studied the many earthquakes caused by fracking in British Columbia. 2009, they started fracking and so did the earthquakes. 272 of them, 38 were bigger than the two here in the UK. One caused so much damage to the structure of the well, they could not complete it. That's a lot of money lost. Case management call on my lawsuit. The defendants want to move my case to Calgary. Why? Usually city people don't care what happens to the people in the rural countries as long as their comforts continue. This is wrong. Alberta Environment's lawyer even said, this tips in our favor. The judge said, well, Chief Justice says it needs to be in Drumheller. This is EnCana's office in Drumheller. These are trucks here. The Synovus office is over there. That's a big building. EnCana's lawyer said, we're not going to drive to Drumheller if the hearing's there. But the frack trucks keep coming and coming. This is the same field of the photos I showed you the year before. Waste from a different well. This is the best grain land in the world. Not this particular field. This is our bread. This is our food. These are wells. The photos look very simple, but it took me about a week to get these photos. It was cold. And I thought I had figured out what the guys were doing, and one of these guys, I don't know, he went the other way and I got sprayed. And I kept filming because I think these are very important, but my sinuses and my throat, for 2 days, the pain was unbelievable. I don't know what's in, I don't know what chemicals are in there. This is not compliant. These are the strips. The other strips last year were over there. That's our food. And the lawyer said, we're not going to drive to Drumheller. We have the legal briefs are filed December 5th. And EnCana boasts on their website that my case has no merit, not supported by the facts. They argued nothing. They filed no legal brief. They argued nothing in court. The regulator, they argued for my case to be thrown out, including the constitutional violations of my rights. They said, I'm a terrorist. They didn't provide any evidence, so they can violate my rights. My lawyers tell me this is pretty serious. And what has shocked Alberta to the core, I feel actually very sorry because I've been the person who made Albertans realize this. The regulator filed in their legal brief no duty of care to any of us or our water. A lot of countries in the world copy our laws and regulations because they are best in the world. But they didn't have emissions in their immunity clause, and that's a big part of my lawsuit, but they claim complete immunity. The water regulator is arguing to have the paragraphs that we talk about the other contamination in our community, they want all those paragraphs struck. They don't want this case to be shared with the world. This is a deep oil frack. It's not in my community, this is west of us. This is what you breathe. When I first moved to Rosebud, I don't like housework. I never had to dust. And before I knew the CBM was in the community, I kept saying to my friends, I could dust every day. I hate this. What is with this dust all over the place? This is a nitrogen frack in my community. They don't respect the dead. This is our graveyard, our cemetery. This is EnCana drilling under my land. The compressors are over here. They fracked the aquifers up here. When you are fracked, there's no aftercare. When you die in an avalanche, the government sends the helicopters and the rescue crews, masses of crews, to find the body. But none of the people that are being fracked in Alberta are getting that care. Why? When there's hurricanes and floods and locusts and hail, the governments help people. But nowhere are they helping the fracked. You have to hold your breath at night. And the government does some more to try to get the Albertans back to sleep. Now they have released real frack regulations for everything. I read them, it's a ridiculous document because they're going to allow this. Laddering, shallow horizontal shales above the basic groundwater protection, deviated wells, they know these cost 50% more, or risk of 50% more gas migration. It's to put the Albertans to sleep. Tiny sample, this is Lodgepole. EnCana fracking above the basic groundwater protection. On the Innisfail blowout, the frack blowout, they blamed fracking in their report. We have a Water Act, we have Environmental Protection Enhancement Act. They could issue fines and severe punishments, nothing. The accidental contamination of fresh water, same thing. Not even under the Water Act did they issue any fines. My court hearing is January 18th in Calgary. The court is packed. I wake up early in the morning. This photo's from a few days later. It was dark. EnCana had a rig about 400 meters from my home. I contaminated a water well. They could drive the trucks out, but the lawyers wouldn't drive to Drumheller. I believe we have to take very strong stands against the unjust things that are happening. I boycotted my own court hearing. I'm paying for it myself. The media keep insisting Greenpeace is financing me. No, I'm selling everything I have. I got a witness and I spent the day in the Drumheller courthouse in the waiting room where I believe the case needs to be heard, where by law it would ordinarily be heard. I didn't know what was going on in the courthouse in Calgary. At 4 o'clock, my lawyers, they actually phoned me at home thinking I'd go home. And then they called the cell phone and said, where are you? I said, well, I'm in the courthouse. You're still there? Of course, I'm taking a stand. The case needs to be heard here. You think I'm going to go home? And they told me how the day went great. It was fantastic. They told me about all the people there, tons of media. I go home to the local paper. This is incredible. Our county councillors love the Tory government. They love EnCana. We've been fracked for 13 years, 12 years. They're not asking to stop fracking until safe or better or best in the world regulations are put into place or that the regulator puts them back until safe methods are developed. This is incredible. Our neighboring county where the courthouse is, they adopted this resolution. A mass number of counties in the central part of the province voted on this and it passed. This is amazing. It's not just my water. This landowner, Chris, he's got bison. He wanted baseline testing. After fracking, his spring went bad. And the company said to him, very similar to what the company told the people concerned about your bath springs here, you've got nothing to worry about. You don't need testing. Our commissioner, our environment commissioner, growth is leaving Canada exposed to disaster. I'm just about finished. Our federal government isn't even asking what chemicals they're injecting. Environment Canada is doing a voluntary survey. What will that tell us? And just before I came, I was working madly away to get ready for this tour in Ireland and here. And Canada took my judge away. If my case had no merit, if they could just rule and say, you have no case, yes, we're completely immune, we have no duty of care, you have no evidence, you can't win, why wouldn't they just rule? We had a case management call with the judge. My lawyer said, well, will you rule on the hearing, at least? Congratulations on your promotion. No, she said that's not an option. Our two options, we start over, big cost to me, delay, or a new judge will read the transcripts. When I took my stand in Drumheller, I asked my lawyers to read into the court my statement, why I wasn't there. My lawyers were stunned that the judge and the defending lawyers didn't object. We think they wanted to know where I was. where is she? What, where, yeah, read the statement. I think they don't like that. I think they want that statement struck, gone, it's in the official transcript. I think it's unjust to make me start over. I think it's unjust to have a judge read the documents and not look Alberta in the eye. Alberta was in the courtroom that day. I wasn't. My case is not for me. My case is for everybody. That includes you. And I was so proud of my fellow Albertans. I didn't know that many people were going to be there because it's their lawsuit too. And they took the judge away. So when you're fracked, there's no aftercare. And I'm, please, I mean no disrespect to everyone here who works in law. Canada has fracked the head of Lady Justice. It's how bad it is. Thank you.